$1,000 if I smash him into that fucking backhoe.
Do it.
$1,000.
Thank you.
Hey, drink some. Drink some.
Oh my God.
Come on.
Hey, I'm
scared. Come from here.
Told you. Oh. Yeah, airbag.
You put on his fucking seatbelt.
It is the law. You don't put on a seatbelt, you'll hurt your face with the airbag. That's what they tell you. Buckle up, it's the law.
His blood alcohol's up to his ears. Nobody would expect him to buckle up.
Yeah, I concur. That was real stupid. You just made a good man suffer.
This is going fucking perfect.
Perfect.
Get the gas can now.
You're siding with him?
I was like the Iceman, okay? Bullseye. Strike.
Suckers. I'll get the gas can. I'll be alone.
Hey, Pepe, it's El Dodd. You okay?
Don't do that right now, please. Don't.
Oh, good, El Dodd.
Well, I thought it would be great at first because I think that it's an interesting story. It's a story that can, if it's portrayed the right way, I think that it can inspire and uplift people. But it didn't turn out to be that way. It turned out to be a comedy. It was very traumatic.
You were tortured.
And I was tortured. But you have to put things on. You know, I survived because of my mental tenacity and able to move. To be able to survive and withstand that. That same mental tenacity has made me, allowed me to move past that.
You may have seen the Hollywood blockbuster, Pain and Gain, but the real life events that inspired are even more unbelievable. Join me as we dive into the chilling true crime story of the Sun Gym Gang. Welcome back to Crime and Wine, and if it's your first time here, then my name is Ariona, or Ari to the YouTube fam, and I cover true crime stories that have inspired the making of movies. If by the end of this video you've enjoyed today's content, then please like and subscribe and leave a comment below. I'd love to hear what movie you think I should cover next. The movie Pain and Gain, which was directed by Michael Bay, was released in 2013 and stars some big names such as Mark Wahlberg, Dwayne Johnson, Anthony Mackie, and includes many other well-known actors like Rebel Wilson and Ken Jeong. This movie is considered an action comedy, but a dark comedy would be a better descriptor. This movie is based on the true crime case of the Sun Gym Gang and their horrendous crimes that they committed. Now, bear with me guys as I go through a bit of information to give you context on the people involved in this case. So now's a good time to grab your wine, put your feet up, and let's get into it. The Sun Gym was located just north of Miami Lake in Miami, Florida, and was a popular spot for bodybuilders, fitness enthusiasts, and even steroids were being sold in the gym. The Sun Gym was known for its hardcore atmosphere and intense workouts. Its reputation attracted a dedicated following of bodybuilders. One of them was actually a man named Daniel Lugo, who also happened to be the manager of the gym. Lugo had a criminal background that included a 15-month sentence at the Eglin Air Force Base Federal Correctional Institute, a minimum security prison camp in Florida's panhandle. And he was also beginning a 3-year federal probation period. The owner of Sun Gym was a Miami accountant named John Meese, and he had opened the gym in January of 1987. He had started bodybuilding during his time at Texas A&M, where he earned an accounting degree. In 1962, while in the Air Force, he was stationed in England, and with a 60-inch chest and 19.5-inch biceps, he won the title of Mr. United Kingdom. The next year, he was accepted as a Mr. America contestant, but the Air Force denied him leave to compete. Daniel Lugo was played by Mark Wahlberg. He was also known for his ability to recruit new members to the Sun Gym and was a popular personal trainer among bodybuilders in Miami. Lugo has been described as a charismatic and persuasive individual who was able to convince others to follow his lead. This is exactly how he was able to form the Sun Gym Gang. Lugo's best buddy at the gym was Noel Adrian Dorval, played by Anthony Mackie. Lugo and Adrian had been friends for a while, and it was Lugo who got Adrian a job at Sun Gym. In mid-October 1994, Lugo held a meeting in his office at the gym where he was with Dorval and had invited another employee of the gym named Stevenson Pierre. Lugo asked the two men if they were interested in making $100,000 for 2 days' work, which consisted of taking down a man named Mark Schiller because he was a bad man who stole money from him and a gym goer slash friend, George Delgado. This may have not been true, but this was the story that he was telling the guys. Now, a little on the connection and target of Mark Schiller. George Delgado's wife, Linda, worked for Mark Schiller in the accounting office, and in 1991, Delgado had to quit his job as a car salesman, and they had begun to struggle financially, and this was when Linda opened up to Schiller, crying over the situation that they were in. Schiller felt bad and offered George a job at his firm, where he ended up becoming a marketing representative. Over time, Schiller and Delgado ended up becoming best friends and business partners. Delgado became extremely financially secured, where his wife didn't even need to work anymore, and they went from living with her parents to owning their own home. Delgado and Schiller were so close that Schiller gave him the security code to his home. Delgado knew the layout of his house and even where his safe was located. He knew Schiller left his pistol and valuable documents locked in that safe. More important, he knew where Schiller banked and the exact locations and dollar amounts of offshore accounts Schiller created for investors. In 1992, Delgado met Lugo at the gym where Lugo was his personal trainer, and they ended up becoming close. At some point, Schiller had sold off part of his business to Delgado, so as part owner, he hired Lugo to be his accountant, and that's when things turned for the worst. Lugo informed Delgado that according to accounting records, Schiller was stealing from him, so Delgado confronted Schiller about this, but of course he denied it, which then angered Delgado, causing him to want revenge. Lugo enlisted Dorval and several other individuals in a plot to kidnap Schiller, with the goal of forcing him to sign over assets equivalent in value to that which Delgado and Lugo believed to be owed to them. They wanted everything that Schiller owned: his home, millions of dollars in offshore accounts, his car, his investment properties, and so much more. So, they got to work on abducting Mark Schiller. The gang had varying plans and made attempts to kidnap Schiller. The first idea was to wear ninja outfits for Halloween, knock on Schiller's door, and abduct him. The next attempt was when the gang dressed in black and wore gloves and black military camouflage makeup, crawled across the lawn, planning to storm the house when Schiller went to get the paper, but a passing car ended up scaring them off. In total, there were 7 failed abductions, but unfortunately, it only takes one for tragedy to strike. On the final attempt, the gang did abduct Schiller. This was done by a new recruit to the gang, a former Sun Gym weightlifting instructor, Mario Sanchez, or aka Big Mario. The gang told Big Mario that they wouldn't hurt Schiller, they just wanted to settle a legitimate debt. He could make a quick grand for just looking big and mean. The gang abducted Schiller as he walked across a parking lot to his vehicle, and just as he opened his door, the gang grabbed him and began to stun him with tasers. Schiller struggled and screamed, hoping someone would hear him, but they forced him to the van and threw him inside. He was held at gunpoint and was told to keep his eyes shut or he'd be dead. His arms were behind his back, handcuffed together, his ankles were shackled together, and on top of all that, his entire head was wrapped in duct tape, covering his eyes and his ears. It was Delgado who owned the warehouse where Schiller was taken after his abduction, and where he was subjected to a catalog of physical and mental abuse. For 2 hours, he was repeatedly tased, punched, and pistol-whipped. They used a lighter to burn his arms and chest. They psychologically tortured him as well by playing Russian roulette against his temple and performed mock executions. He was gagged, blindfolded, and chained to a warehouse wall. The men presented him with a series of spoken scripts that he would be coerced to repeat over the phone to his family and business partners until there was nothing left of his life. The gang held a gun to his head while they listened in on an extension. That night, he called his wife where he said, "Get the kids, get out of the house, don't call anyone, especially the police, and go to your family in Colombia." Schiller said in an interview, quote, "They told me that unless I cooperated, they would bring my wife to the warehouse and rape her in front of me. They also said they would kidnap my son, who was 6, and daughter, who was 2, and chained them next to me. So I made them an offer. They could have anything they wanted if they let my wife and children leave the country. I felt with them gone, the kidnappers would lose their leverage on me. I had only one way to survive, and that was to try to buy my life by giving them what they wanted."
And they were taking some of the furniture they liked and putting it in their own apartments, wearing his jewelry, driving his Dodge Viper and his Mercedes, and just basically living off of his money. Well,
now, remember, with his wife and kids gone, they had full access to his home. Schiller's calls to business associates over the next few days were different. They gave him scripts about having fallen in love with a hot young Cuban named Lillian Torres. She drove him crazy, so loco he was going to convert his assets to cash and ride off into the sunset with her. Also during this time, his captors began making dozens of requests for his signature on various documents. The gang guarded him in shifts. Lugo had limited daytime hours because he had to be seen at the gym in case his parole officer checked up on him. The gang planned for this to be a 2-day abduction, but the abduction went over weeks. The last money transfer was made on December 10th, and after this, the gang decided they would stage Schiller's death because they also wanted the $2 million MetLife insurance policy, which was designated to Lugo's ex-wife, Lillian Torres. A few days later, they decided to force feed him alcohol and sleeping pills. After 3 days of this, Schiller was tossed into the passenger seat of his 4Runner. Lugo drove while the rest of the gang followed in a separate vehicle. They picked a crash site in the warehouse, and when they reached the spot, they strapped Schiller into the driver's seat while Lugo moved to the passenger side. He stomped on the gas pedal and steered the vehicle toward a concrete utility pole. Just before the collision, Lugo jumped out. But when they inspected the wreckage, they found Schiller in the driver's seat, alive, but still unconscious. When they realized he was still alive, they decided to douse him with gasoline and set the car on fire. And as if that wasn't bad enough, they still put a portable propane tank in the vehicle to make sure the job would be finished this time. Miraculously, Schiller gained consciousness and jumped out just in time before the car exploded. But unfortunately though, the gang saw Schiller jump out of the car before it exploded, and as they were driving away, and being that they were determined to make sure Schiller was killed, they turned around and Lugo and Doorbell laughingly shouted to Weeks, who was driving, to get him. So they accelerated their vehicle towards Schiller and ended up hitting him. Now, I don't want to give any false information because depending on the article, this fact differs. But one article said they hit him with the car, pinning him between a wall and their car. Another one said they hit him and Schiller landed on the hood and rolled off the car. And then another one said they hit him and then reversed the car and ran him over again. Either way, he was hit by the car. Schiller was admitted into the hospital on December 16th of 94, but he was treated as a John Doe and possible DUI case. Meanwhile, the Sun Gym gang, after hearing of no one being admitted into the morgue, started calling the area hospitals. They discovered that Schiller was at South Miami Hospital and in critical but stable condition, and it's said that the gang even tried to visit the hospital intending to kill Schiller, but he had already been transferred to a different hospital because he feared for his life. And yes, all of this sounds so crazy and almost hard to believe, which is exactly why the investigators really weren't sure if they could believe Schiller's story that he was telling them. Schiller had to contact a private investigator, Ed Du Bois. Even so, the police department only started to believe Schiller's story when the gang struck again. Now, we're moving on to the Sun Gym gang's next victims, but if you thought Mark Schiller's case was bad, then unfortunately, it just gets worse. For this next case though, especially, I would just like to say that viewer discretion is advised. Doorbell learned of the wealth of a local businessman, Frank Griga, and his girlfriend Christina Furton. Frank Griga and Christina Furtin were both born in Hungary and later immigrated to Canada, where they became citizens. And both of them later moved to the United States and settled in Miami Beach. I try to give a little bit of background on the victims I will be talking about attached to these cases and give them a personality and a story prior to these crimes, but I really couldn't find very much info on Frank and Christina's childhood, upbringing, or family, or really any personal information aside from the fact that Frank was a self-made billionaire and had always been a smart and determined guy. The lead detective of this case was Felix Jimenez, and he talked about the couple saying that they were a, quote, very handsome couple. They looked like they were made for each other. Frank was the American success story, an immigrant, came to this country with $10 in his pocket and made millions. The millions came from him being a successful businessman and entrepreneur who co-owned a phone sex business called Playpen with his girlfriend, Christina Furtin. The two were last spotted together on May 24th of 95, and the next day when the housekeeper came over, she could not locate the couple and discovered that they had abandoned their dog, Choppin. He had been barking ferociously, so she got a very bad feeling from the get-go and decided to call one of the neighbors and best friend of Christina and told her that the couple was missing. The neighbor slash friend knew that Frank and Christina would never leave their dog unattended. He was like a child to them, and they felt guilty even putting him in a kennel. Guys, if my dog was ever left alone, that too would be a red flag. Just saying. They called Griga's Bahamas condo, but there was no answer. She checked the garage and noticed that their yellow Lamborghini was missing, though. Upstairs in the bedroom, the women found two round-trip airline tickets, departure from Miami International Airport at 9 a.m. the previous day. Beside the tickets were two passports, their birth certificates, and U.S. re-entry forms. The couple hadn't boarded any plane, and Bartus, Christina's friend/neighbor, realized that Frank and Christina had never even came home from their Wednesday business dinner. Apparently, Bartus had went over to their house and two men had actually been there, and so they introduced her to them. As the detective of this case stated later, quote, "We had more than that. We had a next door neighbor that had actually been to the house the last time they were seen alive, and they invited her in and introduced her to two muscle-bound men that were driving a gold Mercedes and told them that they were going out to dinner to discuss a business deal. At this meeting, Lugo and Dorbell posed as serious businessmen offering Griga investment opportunities. They ended up setting up a meeting where Griga and Christina were invited over to Dorbell's apartment on May 25th. The plan all along was to do exactly what they did to Schiller. Within minutes of Frank and Christina arriving at Dorbell's apartment, Dorbell was strangling Frank in the bedroom. I guess the plan was to get them to the apartment, make them unconscious long enough to tie them up and all of that so they can begin extracting their signatures and all of that for their assets. But instead, while trying to knock Frank out, Dorbell, not knowing his own steroid strength, either broke his neck or suffocated him, but either way, they accidentally killed him. And I say accidentally because although they planned to kill them, they were gonna wait until they got the signatures, so the intent of killing him wasn't an accident, but the timing of when they did was. At this time, Christina walked in and saw Frank dead, so she screamed, and it was at this time that Danny tackled her and injected her with horse tranquilizer in order to keep her from screaming. They waited a while between killing Frank and the first injection of horse tranquilizer to Christina. They realized they could get all the information they needed from her, or so they thought. So they woke her up, to which she was extremely hysterical, screaming and asking about Frank. So yet again, Lugo had Dorbell administer another shot of horse tranquilizer into her thigh. They begin to ask her for the security code to their house, making sure she didn't doze off unconscious. And it's so extremely sad because she hardly spoke any English and was struggling to not just stay conscious, but to stay alive as they asked her these questions. It's said she mumbled some numbers in which Lugo wrote down, and they injected her yet again for a third time, which sadly killed her. They had injected her with enough horse tranquilizer to kill 4 1,000-pound horses. Now that he had the keypad numbers to Griga's front door, Lugo decided to check out the house. If he could just get to Griga's safe and financial records and into the computer, the mission might not be a total failure. But upon trying the code, it did not work, so he headed back. Realizing they had two dead bodies on their hand, Lugo and Dorville reached out to Delgado and another man to help them dispose the body. Delgado agreed, but the other man ended up not helping. In the end, it was Delgado, Lugo, and Dorville who put their bodies into a large box and couch. Delgado rented a U-Haul so that it looked like a normal neighbor moving, and they drove to an empty warehouse. This is where things get gruesome. The bodies were dismembered by Dorville and Lugo. At first, they tried a chainsaw, but it was not powerful enough. Then, they got a different chainsaw, but it got jammed in Christina's hair. Last, they decided an axe was gonna work. The detectives on this case were Detectives Ferrer and Levine, and they said, quote, "They disposed of the torsos in one part of the county in oil drums, and they left those hands, heads, and feet in buckets at the 31-mile marker in the Everglades on the Alligator Alley that goes from Fort Lauderdale to Naples." When it came to catching these guys, it was a mixture of a variety of things. There was a search warrant that was based on a supporting affidavit submitted by Metro-Dade Police Detective Salvatore Garofalo. Garofalo and personnel from other Miami area police agencies had been investigating the attempted murder of Mark Schiller, along with the murders of Frank Griga and Christina Furtin. The affidavit detailed the information that police had received from Schiller, who described how he knew that Lugo and Delgado were involved in this abduction. It also indicated that Schiller's neighbor, Manuel Salgar, informed police that Lugo was frequently accompanied on visits inside Schiller's home during the time that Schiller was being held hostage by a dark-skinned male who drove a Nissan 300ZX automobile. Based on information from Schiller, police came to suspect that during these visits, Dorville, Lugo, and others removed valuables and other possessions belonging to Schiller. Let's do a run-through of how the Sun Gym gang got caught. A major thing that helped the police was the neighbor-slash-best friend of Christina. She was able to provide the police the make and model of the gang's car and license plate. This gave the police a lead, and they found out who the car was registered to. This helped with obtaining warrants on the houses of Daniel Lugo, George Delgado, Noel Dorville, and John Meese. During this, Lugo fled to the Bahamas, but was arrested 5 days later in the capital of the Bahamas by a multi-agency task force, all because Lugo's girlfriend turned him in. Lugo agreed to reveal the hiding place of the bodies in return for the police mentioning his helpfulness to a jury. He brought them to the submerged barrels where the bodies were stashed away in. The drums did not contain the victims' heads, hands, or feet, which were crucial to the identification. However, Furtin's body was later identified through her breast implant serial number. Remember John Meese, the owner of Sun Gym? Well, he also played a role in this whole case where he notarized a quitclaim deed which transferred ownership of Schiller's home to Lugo's ex-wife, Lillian Torres. He definitely knew what was happening. Police became suspicious about the quitclaim transaction when Schiller informed them that on the date that his wife supposedly signed that paper, there was no question though that she was in South America because she had gone there with their children while Schiller was being held captive. All in all, Noel Adrian Dorville was sentenced to death July 17th of 98 and is currently incarcerated in Florida State Prison awaiting appeal. Daniel Lugo was sentenced to death July 17, 98, currently incarcerated in Florida State Prison awaiting appeal. John Meese, on January 15, 2003, was sentenced to 30 years of imprisonment for one count of conspiracy to commit racketeering, and in 2004, Meese died in prison from a stroke. George Delgado, in return for testifying for the state, was sentenced to two prison terms of 15 and 5 years for his role in the murder of Griga and Furtin and the attempted murder of Schiller. Well guys, I know that was a really sad, upsetting, horrendous, and gruesome case, and my thoughts and prayers are genuinely with each victim's friends and family that was impacted by everything that happened. But nevertheless, thank you for joining me for another episode of Crime and Wine. Leave your thoughts and comments down below and let me know what case you think I should cover next. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you back here next Friday. Stay safe and stay blessed.